Why did Trijet planes disappear? Once upon a time, three engines ruled the skies. One on the left wing, one on the right wing, and one staring you down from the tail like a mechanical cyclops. They weren't just airplanes. They were icons. The DC-10, the L-1011 TriStar, and the Boeing 727. These were machines that looked like they could muscle their way through a hurricane and still land in time for dinner. But look up today, and they're gone. What happened? Why did these magnificent beasts vanish almost overnight? This is the rise and fall of the Trijet, a story of engineering brilliance, fierce rivalry, and one quiet revolution that killed them off without firing a shot. The golden age of the Trijet. Imagine it's 1968. The Beatles are on the radio, Apollo astronauts are walking on the moon, and commercial aviation is booming. People want to fly farther, faster, and with more comfort. But there's a problem. At the time, safety regulations clipped the wings of two-engine airliners. Authorities had what was called the 60-minute rule. If you had only two engines, you couldn't fly more than an hour from the nearest airport. Why? Because if one failed mid-flight, you'd have only one left. And if that one quit too, you were out of options. Over the ocean? That's not inconvenient. That's catastrophic. So what did airlines do? They stuck with four-engine behemoths like the Boeing 707 and the new 747. Four engines meant redundancy, and redundancy meant survival. But four engines also meant high fuel bills, complex maintenance, and a lot of weight. Airlines wanted something smaller, more efficient, but still long-legged enough to cross oceans. And then came the Trijet, Boeing's rebel child. The first true superstar was Boeing's 727. Three engines, the third mounted high in the tail, gulping air through a dramatic S-shaped duct. This wasn't just for style, it gave the 727 insane takeoff performance, perfect for hot, high airports and short runways. It was a hit. Boeing sold over 1,800 of them. Airlines loved it. Passengers loved it. And engineers were starting to realize three engines might just be the sweet spot between economy and safety. But the 727 was a short to medium haul aircraft. The real money was in long haul, transoceanic flying. And that's where the giants of the Trijet world entered the stage. The duel in the skies. Two aerospace titans went head to head in the 1970s. McDonnell Douglas with its DC-10 and Lockheed with its L-1011 TriStar. Why did they both launch so close together? Blame, or thank, American Airlines. They wanted a plane smaller than a 747, but capable of crossing oceans, carrying plenty of passengers, and sipping less fuel than a four-engine monster. The manufacturers jumped at the challenge. Three engines solved everything. With one more than a twin, they dodged the 60-minute rule. With one less than a quad, they saved fuel and cut maintenance. They could fly the Atlantic, the Pacific, even polar routes, all while avoiding the massive cost of a 747. Lockheed's L-1011 was a marvel of technology. It had advanced avionics, quiet engines, and an automatic landing system so good it earned the nickname the Rolls-Royce of the skies. Pilots adored it for its smooth handling. McDonnell Douglas's DC-10 was the wild card. A versatile workhorse that could haul passengers across continents or carry them halfway around the world. Airlines snapped them up. The skies were full of Trijets, and the future looked unstoppable. Enter the acronym that changed everything. Then came the letters that would quietly kill the Trijet. ETOPS. Extended Range Twin Engine Operational Performance Standards. Put simply, what if twin-engine planes became so reliable that they didn't need to stay close to an airport? By the early 1980s, jet engines had gotten much better. Failures became rare. In 1985, the FAA allowed ETOPS flights up to 120 minutes away from a diversion airport. In 1988, it jumped to 180 minutes. That meant a two-engine plane like the Boeing 767 or Airbus A310 could now cross oceans. Legally, safely, and much more cheaply than a Trijet. As one pilot put it, it's not that three engines were bad, it's that two became too good. a brutal numbers game. Here's how dramatic the leap was. A modern GE9X engine used on the Boeing 777X produces 134,000 pounds of thrust, more than all three engines combined on a DC-10. And with ETOPS stretching to 370 minutes today, twin jets can go almost anywhere on Earth with no need for a third engine hanging in the tail. The economics became impossible for Trijets to beat. The tail engine's dirty secret. Let's be honest, that tail-mounted engine looked cool. It gave Trijets their instantly recognizable silhouette, but it was also a nightmare. Lockheed's L-1011 used an intricate S-duct to feed air into the tail engine. It was elegant but heavy, complex, and expensive to maintain. The DC-10 took a simpler straight inlet design, but that came with its issues, including aerodynamic stability problems. And swapping out that tail engine? Ask any mechanic from the era, and you'll see them wince. They were perched 10 meters above the ground. Changing one could take days. In contrast, wing-mounted engines could be replaced in hours. The Chicago tragedy. In 1979, disaster struck. American Airlines Flight 191, a DC-10 departing Chicago, lost its left engine during takeoff due to improper maintenance procedures. The plane crashed, killing all 273 on board. The design itself wasn't directly at fault, but the optics were devastating. Passenger confidence in the DC-10, and Trijets generally, took a hit, changing minds one flight at a time. For decades, passengers believed more engines equals more safety. That's why the 747 became the gold standard. Early twins seemed like a risky middle option, but data told a different story. Modern twins like the Boeing 777 racked up over 100,000 flight hours without a single engine failure. The odds of both failing? About the same as being struck by lightning while winning the lottery. Slowly, the flying public stopped counting engines. They started counting other things. Wi-Fi bars and flight screens, legroom, the beginning of the end. By the 1990s, airlines were under huge cost pressure. Fuel prices were high. Maintenance costs were rising. The Trijet, once the perfect compromise, now looked like a relic. McDonnell Douglas tried to save the concept with the MD-11, an upgraded DC-10 with more range and better fuel economy. But ETOPS had already won. Lockheed's L-1011 never hit its promised performance numbers and sold just 250 units. The MD-11 sold better but couldn't keep up with twins like the 767 and 777. British Airways, Singapore Airlines, and other major carriers dumped their Trijets. Even FedEx, a die-hard Trijet operator, began retiring them. The MD-11 is strong, but it's no longer worth it, one FedEx manager admitted. The last passenger Trijet. The final scheduled passenger Trijet flight happened in 2014 when KLM retired its MD-11 fleet. Today, a few survive as freighters, firefighting tankers, or test beds. Most sit in aircraft boneyards, their paint fading under desert suns. Visit Mojave Air and Spaceport and you'll see them. Ghostly silhouettes of DC-10s and L-1011s, silent reminders of an era when three engines meant freedom. What pilots remember? Talk to any captain who flew one, and you'll hear the same refrain. These planes had soul. The L-1011 in particular was beloved for its smooth handling and advanced systems. The smoothest plane I ever flew, one retired pilot recalled with a smile. Modern jets are more efficient, yes, but efficiency has no nostalgia. The legacy of the Trijet. The Trijet era lasted barely four decades. In aviation terms, that's a blink. But their story is a lesson in how quickly technology changes the rules. They were the perfect solution to a specific problem, a problem that doesn't exist anymore. Today, two enormous, hyper-reliable engines are the undisputed kings of the sky. Will we ever see Trijets return? Almost certainly not. But spot one in the wild, maybe a FedEx MD-11 on approach, or a DC-10 turned aerial firefighter, and you're looking at a time capsule from a bold age of design, a time when engineers didn't just think outside the box, they strapped a jet engine to the box and sent it across the ocean. In the end, the Trijet's disappearance wasn't a crash. It was a quiet fade-out, no big scandal, no catastrophic design flaw, just the slow, inevitable march of progress. Because in aviation, what's essential today might be obsolete tomorrow. And in the 21st century, the numbers don't lie. Two big engines still beat three every single time. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like, subscribe, and drop your thoughts in the comments below. We'd love to hear from you.